Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Awakening of the Seer by EE Holmes. Narrated by Lyssa Browne. 1. Stolen Holiday.
Stop! Stop! I changed my mind! This is a terrible idea!
Hannah shouted.
Don't be ridiculous. This idea is brilliant, just like all my ideas,
I shouted back.
What if it falls? What if it gets stuck? We are going to get in so much trouble,
Hannah cried. I leaned my whole torso out the window and glared down at her.
It's too late now. Just finish tying it already.
Still muttering a stream of quiet objections, Hannah tied the rope to the base of the pine tree. I watched with a satisfied smile on my face as she gave me the thumbs up that she had finished.
Okay, now back up in case we drop it, I called,
then turned to Savannah Todd, who stood beside me at the open window, sleeves pulled up and mischievous grin in place.
Ready, Sav?
Ain't I always?
She replied. We both grabbed onto the rope and began to pull. I wasn't generally the type of person who pulled Christmas trees in through castle windows in the dead of night, but desperate times called for desperate measures. There were three things in life I treated as matters of the utmost importance: snark, coffee, and Christmas trees. Usually, I could just go to a Christmas tree farm or a tree lot like a normal person and put a tree up in my living room. But this year, I would unexpectedly be spending my Christmas at Fairhaven Hall, and so adjustments had to be made. Hannah and I had arrived at Fairhaven just shy of 2 weeks ago to represent our clan at the Erectus, a very important meeting of the Durupinen that convened once every 5 years. Traditionally, the northern clans would gather for a week and vote on important issues and policies that affected our abilities to carry out our calling, to guard the gateways that separate the worlds of the living and the dead. If all had gone according to plan, Hannah and I would have been back home in the States decorating a tree in our apartment. Instead, the proceedings had been upended by the arrival of a shattered spirit, which spread through the castle, possessing unwitting Durupinen and effectively halting the Erectus until all the shards of the spirit could be caught and joined to each other again. So now, the meeting we'd come so reluctantly to attend hadn't even really started yet and wouldn't reconvene until 2 days after Christmas. This was a big problem, because I had a long list of traditions that I indulged in every year without fail. During my whirlwind, nomadic childhood with my mother, Christmas was one of the only constants. No matter what crappy apartment we were living in or how bad her drinking was, I could always count on the same familiar songs, the cookies baked from the same recipes, and, most memorably of all, falling asleep every night in the soft glow of the colored lights on our Christmas tree. There were many sacrifices I was willing to make for my role as a Durupinen, but celebrating Christmas wasn't one of them. Hannah, whose own fractured childhood had been shored up with none of these traditions, was participating in this latest Christmas shenanigan only reluctantly. She'd have been much happier to leave the tree and all chance of getting into trouble, back in the woods where we'd found it. The tree seemed to want the same thing.
It's snagging on something down there, said Savvy through gritted teeth. Can you see what it's caught on?
I can't see anything, Sav. It's pitch black, I panted. At that moment, we both turned at the creaking sound of the bedroom door. I expected to see Hannah, and instead, the friendly face of Mackenzie Miller peeked around my door.
Knock, knock, she said. Anyone home?
Hey, Mackie, I grunted, adjusting my grip on the rope and trying to tug at a different angle. Come on in, but shut the door behind you.
Mackie eased the door closed and then stepped around the bed so that she could see us properly. She narrowed her eyes at me.
What are you up to, then?
I shrugged casually.
Who, me?
I don't know. Definitely not hauling a 9-foot Christmas tree through a 3rd-story castle window with a rope of dubious quality. That would be completely irresponsible.
Oh, blimey! Celeste will have your head, Mackie said, rolling her eyes.
Not if you get your arse over here and help us pull it in before we get caught, Savvy grunted. Come on, then. Be a chum.
Mackie sighed, but jogged over to give us a hand. Together, the three of us managed to squeeze the monstrous tree through the window and prop it up in the corner. I ran back to the window and gave Hannah a thumbs up.
Success! Come on back up so we can decorate it.
I couldn't hear her reply, but there was definitely head shaking and cursing involved.
Someone's going to end up on the naughty list, I shouted down at her before pulling the window shut.
A gusty swirl of snow floated in, making me shiver.
It's kind of monstrous, isn't it?
Mackie was asking as she looked the tree up and down. It could barely stand straight up in the makeshift stand we had jerry-rigged out of a giant old urn.
Where did you get it?
Didn't you hear us call timber over in the grove? Savvy asked, looking disappointed.
You chopped it down on the grounds? Mackie asked incredulously, and then put up a hand.
You know what? No. Don't answer that. I'd rather not know.
Ignorance is bliss, mate, Savvy agreed, slapping her jovially on the back. You're not Ed Girl anymore, so sod the rules and help us decorate this beauty.
Have you got decorations? Mackie asked.
Have we got decorations? I snorted, and held up 2 enormous brown paper shopping bags, crammed with the gaudiest, most glittering Christmas decor we could find.
London has no Christmas left. We bought it all.
What's in that bag? Elf costumes? A Father Christmas suit? Mackie asked, pointing to a 3rd bag on my bed.
Nah, that's some clothes from my mum, Savvy said. She's a seamstress, so when I see something I like in a magazine, I send her the picture and she just knocks something up for me. She made this blouse.
And she gave a twirl, showing it off.
Nice, Mackie said, looking impressed. Well, all right then. I helped you get it through the window, so I guess I'm an accomplice in this nonsense now. Hand me the tinsel.
We just managed to get the lights onto the tree when Hannah came through the door panting.
Believe it or not, I don't think anyone noticed that whole debacle.
It's a Christmas miracle, I cried, plugging in the final strand of lights. Savvy played along by making sound effects of angel voices. Hannah rolled her eyes, but laughed as well. She pulled off her hat and scarf and started digging through the nearest bag for some ornaments.
So, what's on the schedule for this Christmas party, then?
Mackie asked. I'm almost afraid to ask, now that I've seen the tree. You haven't got an actual sleigh on the roof of the castle, have you?
No, no, don't worry. It gets tamer from here, I said. We persuaded one of the cooks to make a batch of all my favorite cookies.
I pointed to the table by the fireplace where a platter was heaped with gingerbread men and sugar cookies. We are going to decorate them while watching bootlegged copies of It's a Wonderful Life and Miracle on 34th Street on my laptop. I also got us all stockings.
To hang by the chimney with care? Mackie laughed.
Obviously, I said. And now, mood music. I queued up my playlist on my phone, and the sultry tones of Bing Crosby filled the room.
Where've you been all afternoon, Mac? Savvy asked. We tried to find you to come shopping with us. Celeste got you working yourself to the bone again.
Mackie sighed.
Yeah, it's been a real nightmare keeping track of who's coming and who's going now that the Arctus is happening after the holidays. We're trying to make sure we've got rooms for everyone and that the kitchens are stocked for the right number of people. Seamus is having a devil of a time making sure he's got enough Keevnors to handle security. And of course, well, everyone's worried about Finvara. We all looked at each other, but didn't say anything. Finvara, High Priestess of the Northern Clans, was very ill. So ill, in fact, that many worried she would not last through the entirety of the Erectus. She had maintained her health for years through leeching energy from spirits as they crossed. But her health had been steadily declining since the practice had been banned more than 3 years ago. No one had seen her out of her tower since the first day of the Erectus, but the updates that trickled down through the ranks were troubling. As much as we didn't want to admit it, there was a very good chance that we would need to elect a new High Priestess before this Erectus was over. And I doubted anyone was as reluctant to admit this fact as Hannah and I were. The death of Finvara meant the crossing of her spirit guide and Keevnor, Carrick, who just happened to be our estranged father. I knew I had to make some attempt at dealing with this fact, but my heart and brain had joined forces in refusing to let me. I made the next move in the epic chess game that was avoiding my own feelings by changing the subject before anyone could vocalize any of these things. "Any idea if Lucida is still in the hospital wing?" I asked. "Check and mate. Take that, feelings." Although I had directed the question at Mackie, it was Savvy who answered.
"I had to go down there this morning for a follow-up with Mrs. Misselmore. Lucida is still there, and still unconscious from what I can tell."
"Celeste says the shattering was a traumatic event for the spirit and for Lucida. It's no wonder Lucida's still laid out," Mackie said.
"Eleonora," I blurted out.
"What's that?" Mackie asked. "The spirit," I clarified. "Her name was Eleonora." Mackie's cheeks colored, and she nodded solemnly.
"That's right. Sorry, mate."
"No, don't apologize," I said quickly. I guess I'm weirdly sensitive about it. Sorry, knee-jerk reaction."
"You don't need to explain weird sensitivities to me," Mackie said with a wink. "Empath, remember? I'm one big walking sensitivity."
I laughed. "Fair enough. So no one's heard any word on when Lucida might be moved?"
"Nah. They can't move her until they can assess the damage, and they can't do that until she wakes up."
"If she wakes up," Savvy said,
and she shrugged, as though she could care less whether Lucida ever regained consciousness again, a sentiment I could heartily appreciate. I heard a small sniffling noise and looked over at Hannah. She was trying to open a package of ornaments, but her hands were now shaking. Immediately, I wanted to kick myself.
"Ah, shit. Hannah, I'm sorry," I said.
I hopped down off the chair I was standing on and dropped to the floor beside her, throwing my arm around her shoulders.
"That was a crappy topic to bring up, and here I am talking about sensitivities like an idiot."
Hannah shook her head and rubbed ferociously at her eyes.
"No, Jess, it's fine. I hate that she gets to me like this. I just need to get over it."
I opened my mouth to object, but Savvy beat me to it.
"Oi!" she cried, making us all jump. "Not a single bloody word out of you about getting over things. That devious old blighter screwed up your life good and proper. You are allowed to feel however the hell you want, for however the hell long you want. And don't you dare apologize for it, yeah?"
A smile crept over Hannah's initially shocked expression.
"Yes, ma'am,"
she said, giving Savvy a military salute.
"That's right, but call me ma'am again, and I will club you over the head with this angel. Savvy warned, swinging the angel around menacingly.
In the true spirit of Christmas, Mackie said, and we all laughed.
I was very impressed with our collective holiday decorating skills. Within an hour, not only had we filled every inch of that enormous tree with glittering decor, but we had hung tinsel garlands all around the room, strung extra Christmas lights around the doors and window frames, and hung the stockings from the fireplace. We'd just put the finishing touches on a wreath on the inside of the door when Milo stuck his head through it. I yelped and dropped the ribbon I was holding.
You will be visited by three ghosts. Clink, clink,
he moaned in a spooky voice. Clink, clink? I asked. What the hell is clink, clink supposed to mean?
You know, chains. Jacob Marley. I forged these chains in life.
Read a book much?
Milo teased, sailing the rest of the way into the room and circling at once, taking in all our hard work.
Ugh, it looks like the dollar store threw up in here. Mine eyes cannot take all this glitter.
Really? Isn't glitter the official currency of your people? I teased. Milo spun and narrowed his eyes at me.
Yes, and you are spending it all wrong. Now watch that sass, or I will revoke your allowance.
I raised my hands in mock surrender.
Okay, okay. So, are you done? Is it present time?
Milo asked, clapping his hands gleefully.
No presents until tomorrow morning, I said sharply.
Milo pouted.
Oh, come on. Aren't you at least going to give me a hint?
You were totally that kid who searched your house from attic to basement until you found all your Christmas gifts, weren't you? I asked him.
No need. My mother kept them all in the back of her closet every year, Milo said. And besides, I never got what I asked for anyway, so what was the point?
He mimed ripping open a present and then gasping in surprise.
Oh, look! More sports ball accoutrement I don't know how to use for teams I don't want to join. Thanks, Mom and Dad.
Well, you are just going to have to wait until tomorrow. I am not spoiling this surprise. It's too good.
Milo gasped.
You can't just say stuff like that and then not tell me what the surprise is.
I grinned an evil grin.
Of course I can. Torturing you is part of my holiday fun.
Milo turned to Hannah, but she shook her head firmly before he could even open his mouth.
Don't even try it. I am not spoiling your Christmas present either.
Ugh, you are the meanest moms ever, Milo grumbled, floating down to rest on Hannah's bed like a grumpy feather.
Did you find Karen? Hannah asked him.
Yes, Milo said, still sounding sulky. She just got back from what I can only assume was a guilt-induced shopping spree. I'm surprised she could carry all the bags.
He looked over at me and pointed a judgmental finger at my all-black ensemble.
And Karen has flawless taste, so your wardrobe undoubtedly just got a major upgrade.
Our aunt had arrived a couple of days ago, after all the chaos of the shattering had ended. Since she had stepped off the plane, she had subjected us to an almost uninterrupted stream of apologies for asking us to come to the Erectus in her place. No matter how many times we told her that we didn't mind and that we'd forgiven her and that it wasn't her fault, she remained racked with guilt. Unsurprisingly, she was now venting her guilt with her credit card. I used to give her a hard time about gifts. But now I knew it would be easiest to just accept whatever she bought me with a smile. She was never able to have any kids of her own, and she had missed out on 18 years of spoiling us. Besides, she was still seething about how the council had treated Hannah during the shattering, so her ire was easily stoked right now.
I was pretty sure I could still hear the distant echoes of the tempestuous tirade she had unleashed on the council on her arrival, and barely a council member had looked us in the eye since.
"Did you tell her about the movie night?" Hannah asked.
She said she'd be up as soon as she finished wrapping, but not to wait for her, Milo said. And I warned her in advance of the foliage, he added, pointing to the tree.
Good idea, Hannah said. I still think we're going to get in trouble for having a tree in here, and I'm positive we're not supposed to be using that either.
She pointed to the massive urn Savvy had found to stand the tree up in.
Aw, no one's going to miss that old thing, Savvy said dismissively. It was just gathering dust.
Mackie took a good look at the urn for the first time, and her eyes widened.
Is that from the Grand Council Room? She asked weakly.
Yep, Savvy said. Swiped it from beside the flagpole and told the Kevnor on duty I was taking it for Christmas polishing.
Mackie dropped her head into her hands.
Sav, that urn is from the 1500s. It's quite literally priceless.
They've got another one just like it on the other side of the throne,
Savvy said, as though that solved the problem.
How priceless can it be if you've got a spare lying around? Besides, we haven't smashed it to bits, have we? We'll put it back on Boxing Day, good as new.
Here, Mac, have a cookie, I said quickly, shoving a fistful of sugar cookies into her hand before she had a chance to argue further.
It will all be fine. Holiday magic, okay?
Luckily for both of you, I'm more interested in eating this cookie than I am in that urn, Mackie said through an impressively large bite.
Excellent, I said,
and looked around me with a sigh of satisfaction. I had successfully conjured nearly all of my favorite traditions in one way or another. My room was a tacky, glittering Christmas fest, my favorite music was playing, and the scents of gingerbread and balsam sap were thick in the air. I'd gathered some of my favorite people around me, and it was going to be a lovely night. The Durupinen might have turned my world upside down, but I had managed, for this one night, to write it again. I crammed an entire sugar cookie into my mouth. It tasted like victory. 2. Wounds and Scars. The castle was pitch black and eerily silent. The only light and movement came from the occasional drifting form of one of the resident spirits, who took as little notice of me as I did of them as I crept down the staircase and through the corridor toward the hospital ward. I knew that Finn would be relieved of his shift guarding Lucida in the hospital ward right at midnight, and that he would head back to the barracks when he had finished to get some sleep before his shift in the morning. If I was going to see Finn on Christmas and actually have a real conversation with him, this might be my only chance. I'd left everyone else sleeping in a Christmas cookie-induced torpor and snuck out without disturbing them. I hovered in the stairwell at the end of the hallway, listening as the Kevnor conferred with each other in low voices. Then I waited with building anticipation as I heard Finn's footsteps come closer. I could tell they were his footsteps. He had a habit of landing a bit more heavily on his right foot, giving his strides a lopsided sound. Yes, I knew the sound of his walk. Pathetic, I know. Finn rounded the corner and stopped short at the sight of me. I lifted a finger quickly to my lips, and he stifled whatever sound of surprise he was going to make. He followed me down a flight of stairs to a deserted landing 2 floors below, where I finally felt it was safe to stop and talk.
"Hi," I said lamely.
"What are you doing here?"
he asked by way of greeting. "I wanted to say Merry Christmas to you, and I wasn't sure if I'd get the chance later," I said.
"Oh, I see. Yes, Happy Christmas," Finn said stiffly.
What had I expected? We'd barely had 2 minutes to speak to each other since we'd gotten into a terrible disagreement. After a passionate tryst in a deserted hut in the woods, I had accidentally suggested that he quit being a Keevnor so that we could be together. I'd never seen him so angry. Not at me, anyway. The distance between us had been palpable ever since. I looked up into his gaze and felt like I could see it there, that distance, like a curtain shutting out the warmth in his eyes. Instantly, I felt embarrassed and angry with myself. "I'm sorry, I shouldn't have come. It was stupid. I just... have a good night. Merry Christmas."
"No, don't go," Finn said quickly. I apologize. I'm tired. It has been a long shift."
"You're not just tired," I murmured. "You're still mad at me." Finn's jaw tightened.
"I'm not mad."
I laughed. "You're doing a really good impression of it." His nostrils flared.
"I am doing my best to keep up the facade that we both agreed was crucial to our cover while here."
"Finn, I'm not an idiot. There is no one else in the stairwell. We are totally alone. There's no reason for the facade right now. Just admit it. You're still angry with me." He didn't reply.
"I'm really sorry about what I said, Finn."
"I don't think my role as a Durupinen is more important than yours as a Keevnor. Honestly, I don't. How could I? How many times have you saved my life now?"
"No one appreciates how important Keevnor are more than I do. I was just upset and frustrated because our callings are standing in the way of us."
Finn's expression softened just a bit.
"Apology accepted. I share your frustration."
"Do you, though?" I asked quietly.
"I don't follow," Finn said.
"Well, it just feels like you're content to leave things the way they are."
"I still don't follow,"
I sighed. "As it stands, this is the only way we can be together." I gestured around us. Secretly, stolen moments, constantly pretending for the benefit of others that we can barely tolerate each other's company. It's exhausting and demoralizing, and yet you seem to feel no real motivation to change it.
"Jess, that's not fair. Of course I wish that things were different, but there are certain realities of our relationship that must be faced. We cannot wish them away, and dwelling on them will only spoil what time we have together. We knew what we were getting into when we started this."
"I know. That doesn't make it any easier to deal with."
"So, would you rather we broke it off?" he asked bluntly.
"What? No, that's not what I'm saying. But nothing is going to change if we don't try to change it." His expression morphed from truculent to wary.
"Change it? How?"
"The erectus is almost over. If we're ever going to speak up..." Finn put up a hand.
"Stop. I know what you're going to say. We can't, and you know it."
"But this might be the only chance we get to..."
"To what?"
Finn hissed.
"To ensure we are discovered? To watch Seamus stand up before the council and reveal what he knows? To say goodbye before the council reassigns me and we never see each other again?"
"We don't know that will happen," I said in a tiny voice.
"You might not. I do," Finn said. "I want the freedom to be together as badly as you do, Jess. But we're not going to get it like this. It's too risky. I won't lose you in a foolish gamble against such odds."
I looked at him, but couldn't finish the sentence. I didn't even know what I wanted to say. I was too confused, too frustrated. This wasn't how I wanted this conversation to go. "It's Christmas. I don't want to do this right now, I finally said.
No, Finn said.
He dropped his arms, and with them, his combative tone.
Nor do I. Look, we're both under a lot of pressure here. In just a week or so, the Erectus will be over. It will be much easier to be rational when we are finally well away from this bloody castle. We will have more time and space to talk. We'll figure it out.
I almost told him about the council seat. This was the moment to do it. If I didn't do it now, it was tantamount to a lie. But the words wouldn't come. I couldn't say them. I couldn't bear to further damage this tiny, fragile snatch of time we had together. It was foolish, but I couldn't do it. Yeah, we'll figure it out, I said instead. You'd better get going. They'll be wondering at the barracks what's keeping you. I turned to go, but he stopped me.
What is that?
I turned back to see him pointing at the parcel tucked under my arm. Nothing. It's just something I was going to give you.
And now you're not going to give it to me?
I shrugged. I wasn't sure that you'd want it. He extended a hand.
May I see it?
Reluctantly, I pulled it out from under my arm and placed it on his outstretched palm. It isn't anything big. He didn't reply, but quietly undid the string and wrapping paper, revealing a small book. It's for your poetry, I muttered, for you to write in.
Oh, I see, Finn said, turning it over in his hand. Well, thank you very much.
You have to open it.
Pardon?
You have to open it. It's not just a plain book. Just open it, I said. Looking puzzled, Finn began flipping through the book. His eyes grew wide.
Jess, this is wonderful.
I had filled the pages of the book with hand-drawn borders and accent sketches, a sort of canvas of my art on which he could record his own. I know you love a good blank page. I mean, I do too, I said, but I thought this might inspire you. Even as he looked at the drawings, his face fell back into lines of misery.
I haven't anything to give you. I didn't think we would be here for Christmas, and I wasn't sure if we...
That's okay, I said quickly. I don't need you to give me anything. I've just been working on this for a while, and so I thought Christmas was as good a time as any to give it to you.
Well, thank you. I look very much forward to writing in it, he said.
You're welcome, I said. We stood awkwardly, and every second that he didn't reach for me and kiss me expanded into an ocean between us. I should go, I said, and left without saying another word. I made it to the bottom of the stairs before the tears started, and halfway down the next hallway before they really started blinding me. By the time I reached the entrance hall, I could barely stifle the sobs. On the final landing of the grand staircase, I sank to the floor, dropped my face into my hands, and let the pain just wash over me.
Jess, are you okay? What are you doing?
I looked up to see Milo hovering just a few feet from me at the base of the stairs. His face was twisted with sympathy.
Sleepwalking, I replied, willing the tears out of my voice and keeping my face carefully hidden. What are you doing down here?
He shrugged.
It gets dull while all you breathers are sleeping.
I was just entertaining some floaters out on the grounds and killing time until I could wake you all up for gifts. I nodded.
So, you didn't answer my first question, Milo said, floating up the steps and coming to rest beside me on the rug.
What question?
I asked if you were okay, Milo prompted quietly.
I'm swell, I insisted.
Would this swellness have anything to do with why I just saw Finn storming out across the grounds? Milo asked.
He was storming? I asked. Even to me, my voice sounded small.
I think storming is an accurate description, yes,
Milo said. There was cursing and kicking and a pretty steady tirade of angry muttering under his breath. He didn't even acknowledge me when I said hello.
Yeah, we're both swell, I said.
Do you want to talk about it? Milo asked quietly. I kept my palms pressed to my closed eyes. The pressure seemed to relieve some of the aching.
There's nothing to talk about.
Come on, Jess,
Milo said, and for once, there was no laugh in his voice, no sarcastic edge.
I'm not an idiot. I might be closer to your sister, but you and I, we're bound, sweetness.
We share an actual psychic connection.
Sure, you've never told me outright that you two are together, but those feelings don't just shut off. They trickle through the connection.
They color everything you say about him. Every time he walks into the room, feeling colored me at that moment, too, as I felt my cheeks burn with the shame of being so transparent.
Color? Really?
Oh, yeah, Milo said. Your thoughts come through all rosy and gold as soon as Finn is involved. It's like that old French song. You talk about him, and suddenly it's La Vie en Rose inside my brain. But psychic connection aside, you are not nearly as good at hiding your emotions as you think you are.
Is that so? I said, keeping my now scarlet face safely behind my hands.
Yes, that's so, Milo said. You think I don't know what it looks like when someone has to hide their feelings for someone they love? Honey, that was the basis of my entire existence from the moment I hit puberty.
I didn't respond. I was trying too hard to push back the tears that were determinedly leaking from my eyes.
You are tough as nails when you know you're being watched,
Milo went on. But it's those other moments, the ones when you think you're alone. That's when your shields come down. And at that point, sweetness, you might as well tattoo his name on your forehead.
I didn't realize I was being so obvious, I said.
Milo chuckled, but the sound was hollow and sad.
Just be thankful that he loves you back.
Okay, story time. I felt him move closer to me, felt his chill as the distance between us closed by a few more inches. Back when I had a pulse, I was madly in love with a boy in my high school. He was your typical testosterone-fueled three-season jock, a vision of perfection in his musky game day jerseys. I was convinced I was flying completely under the radar. I had just transferred from another school, fresh out of one of my dad's scared straight boot camps. After 6 weeks of learning how to be a man's man, I was sure no one would ever guess I was as gay as a Broadway kick line. He laughed mirthlessly. Oh, what a sweet, deluded little creature I was. He saw right through me, and for some reason, he loved what he saw. He absolutely loved that I was in love with him. No one is easier to fuck with than the queer boy who is not so secretly in love with you. I'm not really sure why he did it. Maybe he was secretly gay, full of self-loathing. Maybe he was just a narcissist with sociopathic tendencies. Maybe a little bit of both. Anyway, he made me think he was interested in me. He wasn't subtle about it either. Let's just leave it at that. And I fell for it. Hook, line, and sinker. I was supposed to meet him outside the door to the locker room late one night. I went, my heart pounding like a jackhammer inside my chest. He was there. I couldn't believe it.
He'd brought a six-pack of beer. Not that I drink that swill, but he'd already opened one for me, so I took it. He told me he was going to run inside for a minute to see if the coast was clear. Then, he said, he had something really special he wanted to show me. Tingling with the anticipation of what that something might be, I waited. And while I waited, because I had nothing better to do, I drank. I remember thinking, all of a sudden, that I felt really sleepy, and I sat down on the bench. That's the last thing I remember until I woke up 4 hours later, practically hypothermic, and with the word faggot scrawled all over my face in permanent marker. I kept my face hidden behind my hands, perhaps because I thought that if I looked at him at that moment, I would lose what little control I had left over my tears. "Jesus, Milo, I'm so sorry. That's horrible." He sighed ruefully. "Whatever. I'm over it. That's one of the few perks to so much mandatory therapy. You get to work through shit like that. I'm not telling you because I need your sympathy, Jess. I'm telling you because I want you to know that I get it. I get how hard it is to fight against the feelings and convince yourself you don't feel them. I know what it is to finally let someone in only to get annihilated. And I wouldn't wish that on anyone, really. But I especially wouldn't wish it on you." "And why especially me?" I asked. "Because I'm finally admitting to myself how alike we are, and that's probably why we create a lot of friction. We both have dealt with a lot of bullshit in our lives, which has jaded us. We didn't have any real reason to trust anyone anymore, and so we built our walls of sarcasm, and we piled on our armor of attitude, and we hid behind them. And every once in a while, when someone would breach the defenses, they'd prove to us all over again that we were right to put up the walls in the first place. But those are the moments that betray us, you know? The cracks in the wall that let the love in are the same ones that let it shine through when we try to hide it." "When did you get so sappy and poetic?" I asked him.
"I'm an undiscovered talent, what can I say?" Milo said.
"Finn's emo love poems are nothing to my cheesy love advice. You're avoiding my question, though." "I know. I'm trying to distract you so you won't notice. Is it working?"
"Nope."
I sighed. I took my hands away from my face, and there was nothing to keep the tears from leaking out now. And so they did, dripping freely down my nose and dropping onto the knees of my pajamas.
"You're crying," Milo said in surprise.
"Yep.
I didn't realize. You don't do that very often."
"I know. It's one of the side effects of those walls you were talking about," I said. My voice broke as a sob bubbled to the surface.
"Oh, sweetness, I hear that," Milo said.
"I was the queen of the clandestine ugly cry. You can go right ahead and let it out all over me if you want. For once, I'm gonna pack the sass away. No judgment."
He scooted over so that he closed the distance between us on the floor and rested the full spiritual weight of his form against me. The feeling was intensely cold, and yet so comforting. I could feel our connection pulsing through him, much as I did when Hannah and I grasped hands. And as much to my surprise as his, I did. I let it all out, every aching, wrenching, frustrated tear, until I was all cried out. And as I cried, I told him every single twist and turn in my relationship with Finn that had led us to this moment. It felt just terrible and wonderful at the same time to share it with someone, to lift the burden off myself and release it into the air. It was almost as if by telling Milo, he was helping to carry the weight of it.
At last, I sniffed into silence and looked up at Milo with swollen eyes. I never did understand how Hannah could stand a hug from a ghost, but I have to admit, it's helping.
I'm glad, sweetness.
I don't know how I always manage to screw it up so badly. Is this genetic? Do I have some kind of self-destruct button on all of my relationships that I can't resist pushing?
It does sort of sound like you can't get out of your own way, sweetness,
Milo said, with a small, sad smile.
Is that why you're so upset? Because you have to keep things secret?
I feel like we have this one chance, I said, and despite thinking I had no tears left, I could feel them burning the corners of my eyes again. This one chance with the Erectus to change everything.
This is our opportunity to make a proposal to overthrow the restrictions on Kevnor-Durupinen relationships. The prophecy was the original reason for the restrictions in the first place. And now it's over. If we don't fight for us here this week, I don't know if we'll ever get another chance.
And Finn doesn't want to?
Milo guessed. I shook my head. He thinks it will expose us. Why else would we ask to abolish the law unless we were already breaking it?
Don't you think he has a point? Milo asked. No offense, but it would be a pretty transparent request.
I know it would, I said. But what's the alternative? Tiptoe around for the rest of our lives? Constantly look over our shoulders, convinced that the next kiss will be the one that finally betrays us? I can't live like that. It's only been 2 months, and it's already driving me mad. Milo let out a low whistle.
That is some Capulet and Montague bullshit right there.
No kidding. And we all know how that one ended. Milo looked sternly at me.
I can't believe I'm saying this. But don't be dramatic, sweetness. No one is dying in this scenario.
Maybe not, I said. But it would still be a far cry from a happy ending.
What would the council do, theoretically, if they found out?
Milo asked. They'd send Finn away. They'd reassign him as far from me as they could place him. We would never see each other again, I said. And even the thought of it felt like a punch in the stomach. Milo let out a low whistle.
Damn.
I haven't even told you the worst part yet. Milo's eyebrows disappeared into the artful sweep of his dark hair.
How can it get any worse?
Seamus knows, I said, and my voice sounded dead, defeated. He caught on to what was happening 3 years ago when we first got back from Fairhaven. He threatened Finn, and that was why we never... Why, nothing ever happened between us back then.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, Finn says he's sure the Kevnor don't have a clue about us now, but if we propose to the council to lift the ban...
You're screwed.
Bingo, I said. And I get that. I get why he's scared. I'm scared, too. Terrified, actually. But the thing is, Finn is such a fighter. He's fought his whole life. It's how he approached... almost every situation he's ever faced. And I just wish he would fight for us. We sat together for a silent minute. Milo's chill continued to sap away the intensity of my sadness, dulling it, like ice on a wound. I haven't even told him about Hannah running for the council seat, I confessed at last. Milo's eyes widened.
He doesn't know?
No. He knows that Finvar is going to nominate us, but he doesn't know that we're going to accept the nomination. I saw Milo staring at me and added defensively, "There's been no time. We just decided the other day, and he's been constantly on duty."
But you were just talking to him alone. Why didn't you tell him then?
Milo asked. I couldn't do it. I said, The corners of my eyes burned, but I had no tears left to shed. I know I should have, but I chickened out.
So he still thinks we're going home at the end of the week? Milo asked.
Yes, I said. And let's be honest, we probably are. No one is actually going to vote for the apocalypse twins for the council.
Yeah, but even so, you have to tell him, Jess, Milo said. This is his life, too. And this is too big a decision to make without him, especially if you want to stand a chance of staying together.
I know, I cried, dropping my face into my hands again. My head was beginning to pound with the monster of a headache that only a good cry could produce. So, now you know everything. I've completely poured my heart out to you. You're my spirit guide. Guide me. What should I do?
I don't think you should do anything, Milo said quietly.
But let me finish, he said, putting up a hand. I don't think you should do anything on your own. This isn't something you can do unilaterally, not when it affects you both so much. If the two of you want to wind up together, that's how you have to make the decision. Together. You have to come clean about the nomination, and you have to promise him that you won't bring up a measure to abolish the relationship rule unless you both agree that it's the right thing to do. I sniffed a few times, absorbing his words. That is really good advice, I said finally.
Don't sound so surprised. My time as a spirit guide has made me wise beyond my years, Milo said with a sigh. It's exhausting, being so full of sage wisdom and having to dole it out to all you foolish living people.
Well, thank you. Thank you for exhausting yourself for my sake. I really do appreciate it, I told him.
Any time, sweetness, Milo said.
And I mean it. Talk to him. Talk to him again. Keep talking until the two of you talk yourselves onto the same page. And another thing, too.
What?
Just now you said that Finn has been a fighter his whole life, and that's how he approaches every situation, except this one. But really, that should show you how special you are to him. He knows that fights don't always go your way. Sometimes you lose. And losing you? That must be unthinkable for him. Milo, don't tell anyone I said this, because I will deny it until my dying day. But you are the best. Seriously, I said.
Don't worry, I won't rat you out, he said, with a trace of a laugh in his voice.
And don't tell Hannah all this stuff about Finn. I want to tell her myself.
Cross my heart and hope to... Well, you know what I mean,
Milo said with a smirk. Come on, I said, standing up. Milo looked startled at my abrupt command.
Where are we going?
Upstairs to the room. It is... I checked my watch. 12:37, which makes it officially Christmas. I'm not going to make you wait a minute longer for your present.
Wait, for real? I get it now?
Milo squealed, his face lighting up.
Yes, right now. Let's go.
3. Milo's Closet. Milo blinked out to conserve energy, but I felt him with me all the way back up to our bedroom, hovering beside me like a candle I was using to light my way. Finally, I closed the door behind us and flicked on the lights.
Jess, what's going on?
Hannah asked, rolling over and rubbing her eyes.
Who's there?
What the bloody hell is happening?
Savvy cried, squinting in the brightness. Then she spotted me and seemed to remember where she was.
Mate, what time is it?
It's almost 1 o'clock, but Christmas is officially starting, I announced.
Do I need to be conscious for it? Savvy grumbled.
You're going to want to be conscious for this. We're giving Milo his gift.
Now?
Hannah mumbled. Right now. Cannot wait. Need to do it immediately, I cried. I reached into the bag of Christmas trappings and tossed a Santa hat to each of them. Savvy pulled hers over her eyes and flopped back down on the couch. Hannah, however, sat up, rubbed her eyes, and put the hat on. Where's Mackie? I asked, looking around for her, an extra Santa hat clutched in my hand.
She went back to sleep in her own room, Hannah yawned.
She said if Savvy kicked her one more time, she'd have to kill her, and that wasn't in the spirit of Christmas.
Oh, I said, thrusting the hat onto my own head instead. Well, her loss, and I doubt Karen wants us to wake her up either, so let's get started.
But why are we doing this now, in the middle of the night? Hannah asked again. Because Milo and I just had a moment, and I can't wait anymore, I replied.
Aw, you guys had a moment without me? But you know how much I love to see you getting along, Hannah said, pouting.
Yes, it was very touching. Don't get all excited, though. We aren't going to make a habit of it. It would mess with our love-hate dynamic, I assured her.
Exactly. I don't think Jess and I could survive without a steady diet of witty banter, Milo added. Hannah was still looking pouty.
It was a spontaneous moment, okay? I said, waving my hand impatiently. The point is that I needed to talk to someone, and Milo was in the right place at the right time, and he was brilliant. So now we need to reinforce his good behavior with gifts.
I plopped down on my bed, pulling my laptop from under it and flipping it open.
What's going on? Milo asked. My present is on the computer?
Of course it is. What did you think I was going to give you? A sweater? You don't have a corporeal form.
I pulled up what I was looking for on the screen, but I tilted it away from Milo so that he couldn't see it.
Okay. So, do you remember last week when I dyed my hair and you flipped out on me?
Righteous indignation is hardly an overreaction when it comes to fashion. But yes, proceed, Milo said in a dignified voice. I was confused at the time. I couldn't understand why you were so mad at me. But then I figured it out, I said.
Milo's smile slipped.
Oh, really? And what exactly did you figure out, Sherlock?
Well, I already knew you had a real passion for the fashion world when you were alive, I said, trying to keep my voice light and even, refusing to give in to the sadness at the heart of what I was saying. Hannah told me it was your dream to design your own couture line and have your own runway show at Fashion Week. Is that true?
Milo shrugged, hoisting his armor on more securely against whatever emotions I was stirring up in him.
It was a pipe dream. Everyone's got one. You probably wanted to be Rembrandt. I didn't really think it was going to happen or anything.
I may never be Rembrandt, but it won't be because I didn't get a chance to try.
That's not the case for you.
Hannah was looking wary. Even Savvy had sat up and pushed the Santa hat up onto her forehead so she could see. Milo didn't respond. Maybe he couldn't. I went on so that he didn't feel like he had to.
So then I started thinking about all the times you've given me unsolicited fashion advice, all the times you've suggested what to do with my hair or my accessories, all the times you begged to supervise our makeup application, and I always give you such a hard time about it because I always thought you were just nagging me. But then I realized it was more than that.
Not really, Milo said with a too careless wave of his hand. Someone had to take you in hand. Seriously, girl, you are tragic.
I smiled. Nice try, but we're going to lay off the snark for a few minutes because it's Christmas, and on Christmas, we get real, I said.
I realize that helping Hannah and me is the only opportunity you get to do what you truly love, and it never occurred to me that I might actually be hurting you when I said no. I'm really sorry, Milo. Milo didn't speak. His face was twisted with long repressed pain. For a moment, I wondered if I had gotten too real for him, and if he might just blink out to avoid the bluntness of what I had just said. But then he nodded in acknowledgement of my apology. No one does more for us than you, Milo. And you do it all the time, day and night. And you never complain, even though you didn't know what you were getting yourself into when you bound yourself to Hannah, I said.
I don't regret that part, Milo blurted out. I've got regrets, but not about being a spirit guide. Not many ghosts get that kind of chance to do something really meaningful after they die. I do, and I'm grateful for it.
I know. Hannah and I will never be able to thank you enough. But we can do this one little thing to show you how much we appreciate you. So, Merry Christmas. I turned the computer around so that Milo could see the screen. He looked at it for a moment. Then his eyes widened. He floated toward it, his mouth hanging open.
What is that?
He whispered. He pointed to the top corner where the name of the blog curled across the screen in glittering fuchsia script. Milo's Closet. It's a fashion design blog, or at least it will be once it goes live.
I don't understand. No offense. But you don't know the first thing about fashion.
True, but you do, I said. Milo stared at the screen, then back at me.
I still don't get it, he said finally.
It's a blog for your designs, so that the world can see your ideas and know how stupidly talented you are, I said. One corner of Milo's mouth twitched into a suggestion of a smile, but he still looked utterly bewildered.
How is that supposed to work?
I'm dead. I can't blog. Not by yourself, no. That's why we'll be here to help you. No, seriously, listen, we've figured it all out, I said, because he was still looking skeptical. Here's how it will work. When you get a design idea, we habitate. You can use me to sketch the design for you. A slow smile began to spread over Milo's face.
So, we can post the sketches for people to see. That's pretty cool.
No, it's more than that, Hannah chimed in eagerly. When the design is done, we use Savvy's mom to construct it for us.
I've already asked her, and she's tickled to get started, Savvy said through a yawn. She's dead clever with the sewing machine. She can make anything you like, quick as a wink.
When the clothes are done, Savvy and Hannah and I can model and photograph the designs for you. Then you tell us what to write for the blog entry, and we post. You'll be famous in no time.
You would do that for me?
Milo whispered, his expression stunned.
Of course, I said. But you hate having your picture taken. Are you seriously going to let me dress you up in whatever I want and then spread the proof of it all over the internet?
I shrugged. You've lent us your soul for the next 70-odd years, so we're lending you our bodies. I am your canvas. I quickly adopted a businesslike tone. Of course, I absolutely refuse to be photographed wearing anything that isn't black, and you can only photograph me from my left side with no uplighting, and under no circumstances can you force my giant feet into stilettos.
And I won't wear nothing that don't show my girls off, so keep them dresses low-cut, yeah?
Savvy added with a wink. Milo threw his head back and laughed.
I can't believe this. This is just incredible.
His smile faded.
But what if people actually start reading it? Won't my cover be blown? Isn't this against the Durupinen Code of Secrecy? I don't want to wind up in front of the council again.
I shrugged. People pretend to be other people on the internet all the time. If anyone ever wants to interview the famous designer Milo Chang, they will have to do it over email or by phone. It will enhance your mystique. Milo squealed.
This is... I can't even tell you how much this means to me.
But we haven't even told you the good part, I said. Milo laughed.
The good part? What could possibly be better than this?
I looked over at Hannah, who was so excited that she had pulled her pajama shirt up over her mouth to muffle the little squealing noises she was making. I put in a call to the one and only celebrity I know, who just happens to owe me a huge favor. Once we're up and running and your first collection is done, she's going to wear one of your pieces out to one of her movie events. Milo's form went pale.
You can't possibly mean...
Oh, yes, I can, and I do. The one and only Talia Sims has agreed to be photographed in public in a Milo Chang original. With a shiver and a pop, Milo vanished on the spot. We all sat there for a moment, staring around for him.
Milo? Are you okay? Hannah called, a laugh in her voice.
Am I okay? If I hadn't already died, I'd be dead!
Milo shrieked through our connection, so that Hannah and I had to clamp our hands over our ears to stop them from ringing.
I can't remember how to manifest!
I laughed aloud, despite the agonizing pain in my head.
Well, calm down and figure it out before you make my skull explode.
Sorry, Milo sang. This much fabulousness combined with this much excitement is just impossible to contain.
So you like it?
Hannah asked, rocking backward and forward on her knees.
I wasn't sure whether you would want to put your stuff out there. Aren't you worried it's going to be stressful? People critiquing your ideas?
With what felt like a massive mental effort, Milo lifted himself out of the connection and wavered back into physical form. He was grinning from ear to ear, and his eyes were shining.
Sweetness, if anyone understands the phrase, life is too short, it is yours truly.
I never thought I'd get the chance for anyone to critique my ideas. People just don't get second chances like this. I'm not going to let a little fear stand in the way when I finally have the chance to get a taste of what I've always wanted.
He caught my eye, and I winked at him. Neither will I.
Well, we're awake, Hannah said, shrugging. Should we just exchange the rest of the presents?
Can my gift be more sleep? Savvy moaned, flopping back over.
Yeah, I'm too excited to go back to sleep now, I said. Grab those stockings and let's dig in.
In all, it was a much better Christmas than I would have thought possible while being stuck at Fairhaven Hall. We tore through all the gifts under the tree in less than an hour, gorged ourselves on Christmas cookies, and slept the rest of the morning away. Mackie shuffled in with coffee around 9 o'clock, and Karen turned up an hour later with an excessive number of gifts, which we dutifully opened and squealed over. The dining room was set up with a lavish breakfast buffet so delicious that we trekked down twice before we pronounced ourselves too stuffed to eat ever again. Around 2 o'clock, Tia interrupted our Christmas movie marathon with a Skype session, during which she lamented our absence but gushed profusely over the British-themed box of gifts I'd mailed to her.
"When are you coming home?" she asked.
"I'll keep you posted," was all I could say. Of course, we had no idea what the answer to that question would be. If Hannah actually managed to win the council seat, a long shot, it was true, but still, we wouldn't be coming home at all. At 4 o'clock, we somehow found ourselves hungry enough to stuff ourselves silly with a mouth-watering traditional English Christmas dinner. After several plates full of roast turkey and goose, goose-fat roasted potatoes, sage and onion stuffing, pigs in blankets, sprouts, Yorkshire pudding, mince pies, and Christmas pudding with brandy sauce, I thought Hannah was going to have to roll me up the stairs to our room.
"Wake me up for next year's Christmas dinner," I groaned, flopping onto my bed, which creaked more than usual.
"Same," Hannah sighed, collapsing into a chair by the fire. She was still wearing one of the tissue paper crowns that came inside the Christmas crackers Savvy gave us at the table. She had demanded that every single person wear their crown and then forced us all to read the jokes aloud. She roared with laughter at every single one, whether it was funny or not.
"I must admit, I missed Christmas at Fairhaven," Karen said, stifling a yawn. "It was always such a wonderful celebration, and I see it hasn't changed."
She sunk into a chair and sighed, kicking off her shoes and rubbing one of her feet.
"Well, I'm glad you girls have decided to stay for the rest of the Erectus. I think that you'll learn a lot, and I'm proud of you for sticking it out, in spite of how terribly it all went wrong in the beginning. But we'll be done soon, and then you won't have to be in that council room for another 5 years."
She smiled. I looked at Hannah. She shrugged her shoulders and nodded. I didn't need our connection to decode her answer to my unspoken question. "Yep, we have to tell her. It's now or never." "Karen," I began, sliding off of my bed and coming to sit in the chair beside Hannah, "we need to talk to you." Karen's expression was instantly wary. She dropped her aching foot and sat up straight.
"I don't like the sound of that."
"What is it?" she asked.
"We have something we want to tell you, but it would be great if you would let us tell you the whole thing before you started freaking out," I said.
"Jess, you can't begin a conversation with a statement like that and expect me not to start freaking out," Karen said exasperatedly.
"I'll get to the point then," I said.
I looked at Hannah and she nodded encouragingly. "When we first got here for the Erectus, Finbara called us to her office. She said she had something important that she wanted to share with us."
"Okay," Karen said slowly. She was picking anxiously at a thread on the hem of her sweater. If she didn't calm down, she was going to unravel the whole damn thing into a pile of cashmere.
"She started by apologizing to us. Well, to our whole clan, really. She said it was her fault that we lost our council seat and that she had lots of regrets about the way she treated our family in the wake of Mom's disappearance."
"As well she should," Karen said bitterly. "And she's not the only one either."
"Finbara told us that she wants to make it up to us by nominating our clan for the open council seat," I said.
Karen just continued looking at me as though I had not spoken.
"Karen, did you hear what I said?"
Karen gave her head a little shake.
"She told you what? I'm sorry?"
"The open seat on the council, the one that they stripped from Marion. She is going to nominate our clan for it," I repeated a little more slowly.
Karen laughed incredulously.
"And how exactly does that constitute an apology? It's an empty gesture. She already knows that I will have nothing to do with this council. What does she hope to prove by nominating me for a seat that she knows I will never run for?"
"Yeah, she knows you won't have anything to do with it. That's why she told us instead of you."
She was hoping that Hannah or I would make a run for it. Karen laughed again, louder this time.
Has she lost her mind?
I looked at Hannah again. Well, no, but Hannah and I might have.
Karen stopped laughing abruptly.
What do you mean?
Hannah cleared her throat.
We decided that I'm going to run for the seat.
Karen looked back and forth between the two of us with a strange half-smile on her face, looking to catch one of us in a lie. The smile slowly faded into a blank look of horror as she realized that there was no punchline.
You cannot be serious, she said weakly. What in the world would possess you to do something like this?
I jumped in because Hannah was already looking discouraged.
Well, before you jump to conclusions, you should know that no one else influenced this decision. We didn't tell anyone or ask for anyone's advice. We came to this decision totally on our own.
We also didn't decide right away, Hannah added. We've been thinking very carefully about it for days.
Yes, but how you could be thinking carefully about it and yet still come to this decision is what alarms me,
Karen cried, and then immediately closed her eyes and took a long, deep breath.
No, I am not going to flip out on you. She looked up and caught my eye. I can only assume that's why you didn't call me to tell me about it in the first place. You thought I'd go ballistic?
Something like that, I said. And then the shattering happened, and suddenly the council seat was the last thing on anyone's mind.
Right. Yes. Okay, Karen said, and she still gave the impression of someone fighting every natural impulse to lose her cool. Why don't you start by telling me why you decided to do this? What was your logic? I want to understand.
I was the first one to consider it, Hannah said, falling on her sword as though she hoped to salvage my dignity. I saw it as an opportunity to help shape Durupinen policies rather than being victimized by them all the time. Jess wanted nothing to do with it, wouldn't even entertain the idea, but then she began to change her mind.
I see, Karen said, her voice calm, but her nostrils flaring. And what was it that caused you to change your mind, Jess?
It was a lot of things, I think, but mostly it was the shattered spirit, Eleonora. She was a caller, and her counsel destroyed her. No one was there to speak for her or to protect her from the same fear-driven policies that followed us when we got here. She died because they thought she and her sister might be us. We can't change that. But we decided we couldn't ignore it either. Karen froze. Her eyes widened. All of the anger and exasperation drained from her face, and she suddenly looked less like a cutthroat lawyer and more like a lost little girl.
From what you and Finvara told us about our grandmother, it doesn't really sound like our family used our power or influence for good when we had it before, Hannah said.
Karen allowed herself a sardonic smile.
No, my mother saw power as little more than currency to barter for what she wanted. It would not have occurred to her to use it to help anyone but herself.
A lot of the council seems to feel that way, Hannah continued. And most of those clans have been in power for a long time. In fact, most of those same clans held those seats when they sentenced Eleanor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.